Hello and welcome to this episode of our program, Daily Debate. Today, as usual, we will be discussing a very contentious debate. Today, we'll be discussing the new Russian bid for a Daba'a nuclear plant. And of course, this is fulfilling the dreams of an Egyptian nuclear project that has stalled for more than 60 years. Now, the long-awaited plans for the construction of a Daba'a nuclear power plant in Egypt has finally taken shape as President Fattah al-Sisi met with the high-ranking officials. Of course, we're speaking about the Prime Minister and the Minister of Electricity and others. And he gave his instructions to finalize all the legal and technical procedures in order to implement this Russian bid to establish the power plant in the Daba on the Mediterranean coast west of Alexandria. President Fattah al-Sisi, as I said, met with the Prime Minister, Sharif Ismail, Minister of Electricity, Mohammed Jaker, Minister of Finance, Hani Qadri, and the head of the Financial Affairs Authority for the Armed Forces. Both the electricity and finance ministers displayed the benefits of the Russian nuclear power plant. Construction of the nuclear plant is scheduled to commence or to start in 2016 and will be completed by 2022. The Russian company will build 4 reactors while another 4 are currently up for an international tender. This is exactly our debate today, and this is exactly what we are going to discuss, the significance of this nuclear plant and more. We will be discussing this later on in our show. Before we start with our discussion, let me first take the headlines of the day. And President Sisi heads national security meeting on domestic international security threats. A presidential statement said that President Fattah al-Sisi headed a national security meeting today. An informed source said that the meeting was expected to discuss current domestic and international security threats, as well as the latest details on the investigation into the Russian airliner crash over the Egyptian territory, and, of course, updates on the Ethiopian dam situation, as well as many other domestic issues, including the economic and sustainable development in the country. Our next headline was, is France will destroy Daesh, according to the French president. And French President François Hollande has told a rare joint sitting of both houses of parliament that his country is committed to destroying the Daesh terrorist group after Friday's deadly attacks. He said he would table a bill to extend the state of emergency declared after the attacks for 3 months. France's military campaign against Daesh in Iraq and Syria would be intensifying. And that was very much obvious today, I guess, to highlight, to have a spotlight on the issue we have with us over the phone, Mr. Mahmoud Tulba, who is a strategic expert. Hello?
Hello.
Yes, good evening to you, sir.
Good evening. Thank you.
We're speaking about the French president declaration today that he would ask the French parliament to extend the France mission in, or rather against Daesh. How did you view such declaration? What significance does it make?
Okay, if you just read the French statement that the last attack has been planned in Syria and demands from Belgium, executed in Paris, France, and also is funded from many elsewhere, we understand that the terrorism activity have been faced today, the global one. And the efforts with Russia offer is in Syria doesn't enough with the Americans. So France will doing more work in that. Started from the declaration from the parliament to extend the state of emergency for 3 months. I think because also they need to team and look around the country itself. It's very hard to just say it's good, even fence or just finish the terrestrial activity in France in short time. I think more than 6 months or 3 months would be extended more. And also we hear today that French aeroplane have been attacked the many target in Syria, in Daesh area. And it is very important activity too. But I don't think that, I think Holland is just still activated and by the accident doing effort should be a global one, not for only one state. So I think France with the United States, with Russia, with Egyptian countries, Egyptian and other Arab countries like Saudi Arabia and Emirates should be shared together to end the terrorist activity in Syria and Iraq.
Yes, if we're speaking strategically wise, and of course we have seen the US-led coalition against terrorism that was launched times ago. And now we're seeing Russian interference, which has caused real change in the whole strategy of this area. And now France. So to which direction are we seeing here the next steps, particularly in this area?
Okay, first look to the American strategy and policy. First of all, we find that Americans have in mind to start by air power, using air strikes against Daesh, and according before Turkey joined with its air bases to reopen it for the American fighters to fly from there. I think it was very hard and very difficult from strategic and the military perspective to just launch a very effective air strike against Daesh. Its move after the Turkish were working and joined the strike. And also with Russia coming to Syria to support the Bashar and started another air strike, we still find that just Daesh will control some area. Now with France coming to the game, we have three main powers. We have France, Russia and United States. I think the next step will be using the ground forces. Fighting from the air is not enough. And we understand that all. Never air forces could end the threats on the ground. We still need now forces working on the ground.
If we're speaking about this situation we're seeing here, and we're seeing the United States start with its so-called war against Daesh, and then Russia entered into the battlefield, and of course it has changed lots and lots on the ground. Now we're seeing France. From your point of view, can this really be in favor of the crisis there in Syria in other and of course other Middle East countries, or it would be against?
Okay, very good question. We have to look at it from two perspectives. First of all, we have three powers working now together to fight against that. It's a very good thing. Very three countries working. But also, where is the Arab countries? We need to share with them their efforts to doing that. It is we don't know what is their objective, their target, their plan. I think it's very important to declare for the three countries and to get together to have a joint operation control all the activities there. I think you remember if the Russians have refused to United States to share their activity in Syria in one time. And maybe it will really change now. So important, very important element here, all the parties coordinate together in favor of the area. If they didn't do, I think it's not good for the Arab countries.
Yes. Finally, and very briefly, sir, how do you view the world's or the international community at large's response towards terrorism? Was their beefing up to the security situation enough to counter and really eradicate terrorism? How do you view the international response?
The international response is not doing enough. It's clear. I think one most important thing, how the intelligence activity cooperate together. If you look in three accidents just happened in one after one. The activity in Lebanon, and the Egyptian, the Russian aeroplane in Egypt, and the activity in France. Three terrorist activities in three different areas of the region, and coming together and deploying someone is Daesh. ISIS is behind all the activity. I think there is a line of communication and a line of information. We should share information and participate to the other to fight the terrorism in the three areas. I think the two main elements of any terrorist activity is the human being and the financial. We need to deal with these two points. First, to deal with Daesh, we need to cut off all their financial resources, oil, any other resources in Syria and Iraq.
Yes,
the second, to stop human beings to travel and join the Daesh in Syria and Iraq.
Yes, a full strategic integral strategy in order to be able to confront and eliminate terrorism. That is very much needed. General Mahmoud Tulba, strategic expert, thank you very much for being with us. Over to our discussion. And of course, after this historic achievement of the New Suez Canal project in a record time, as directed by President Fattah al-Sisi, he moved on to another mega project. This mega project would be, with God's will, the Egyptian nuclear plant. Let's watch the report and we'll come back for discussion.
President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi has signed off on commencing work on Egypt's first nuclear reactor in El Dawa, west of Alexandria, which will be carried out by Russian-owned Rosatom company. Plans for Russia to construct the nuclear plant were first announced during a visit of Russian President Vladimir Putin to Egypt in February 2015, where both leaders signed a memorandum of understanding to build the nuclear power plant. On Thursday, President al-Sisi met for the second time with the CEO of Rosatom, Sergei Kirenko, to discuss the financial and technical requirements to construct the nuclear plant. The first meeting was in August during the president's visit to Moscow. Cairo had earlier announced that Rosatom made the best offer from a financial, technical and political perspective, beating offers from other countries including Japan, France, South Korea and China. The Russian offer distinguished itself from the other in seven areas. Most important, the Russian company will produce 100% of the power plant's components and will not rely on the import of plant components from other countries. The Russian company will also establish an information center to promote popular acceptance of nuclear energy. Egypt would have to pay off the nuclear plant after it is completed and is in operation. In addition, Russian factories will be established in Egypt to manufacture nuclear plant components locally and transfer Russian expertise in this field to the Egyptians. The project was announced in 1955, then was stalled during the presidency of Gamal Abdel Nasser because of the 1967 war. In the 1970s, the project was bid upon in a competition between U.S. companies after U.S. President Richard Nixon promised to provide nuclear plants to both Egypt and Israel. Then a U.S. law was passed obliging countries acquiring nuclear plant technologies to subject to inspection standards from the country of origin, which is America, so the project stopped. In the 1980s, there was competition between U.S. and French companies. Then came the Chernobyl incident. In the 1990s, the decision makers moved away from the project because of the discovery of gas, which was sufficient to cover Egypt's needs for a while. Then in 2006, under President Hosni Mubarak, the idea emerged again, and Egypt started its procedures with the International Atomic Energy Agency, IAEA, to build a nuclear plant in El Dawa. There was widespread controversy in the popular and political circles about whether the location was suitable for the project until government in 2009 restored an Australian company to review the appropriateness of the Dawa nuclear reactor. The results of the study prepared by the Australian company were presented to the IAEA, which certified that the Dawa was a suitable location based on meteorological conditions, earthquake risks, groundwater movement, sea currents and tides, as well as demographic studies. But the government did not start implementing the project until the time of the January 25th revolution in 2011. The project was revived again in 2013 2018 under interim president Adli Mansour.
Right, welcome back to our discussion. The Daba nuclear facility plant, and President Fattah al-Sisi has given his instructions for the top officials to finalize all measures and details of course, to facilitate the Russia bid. Let me first welcome our guests here, Dr. Ibrahim Oseiry, Nuclear Affairs and Energy Advisor at the Ministry of Electricity. Thank you very much for being with us. Dr. Yusef Mazhar, former Undersecretary of the Ministry of Industry. Thank you very much for joining us. And let me start by asking about the Russian bid. And what distinguished the Russian bid than any of the other bids that were offered to Egypt?
Actually, the main point is that the Russian have the capability to construct the nuclear power plant from all its aspects. Mm. They don't need to get some equipment from other country that may make some pressure on it. And it is surprising to say that the first nuclear reactor in the world was done by the Russian in 1954. The first reactor in the world. After that, other reactors followed.
But if I may ask you here, sir, but the countries who were bidding for that were Japan, France, South Korea, and China. And those countries, I guess, have all the tools and all the equipments needed for that. So what is very significant about Russia?
For the other countries, no country of them depend on its manufacture completely, 100%. They need the support of other countries. Mm. If you look to South Korea, for example, they are building now 4 nuclear power plants in Emirates, but they have some components made by the Americans. The Americans made pressure on the Emirates to sign a contract that they will not make enrichment, they will not make reprocessing and other conditions, and that they have the right to inspect on these reactors. It's something like that.
Yes, sir. I will reiterate the same question, but from other perspective, if we're speaking about industry-wise, why is Russian bid so significant?
All right. Of course, my colleague has pointed out the most significant technical point about the overall capability of Russia. But there are other factors. As you know, to build a power plant politically is a big problem. Mm. People seem to associate power plants to have the ability of playing around with atomic energy, which is not quite true. With Russia, you are sure you can build it as they did. Actually, they built Iran, and nobody could stop them. Even when international, pressure was against Iran not to do that, but Russia was capable of continuing and finalizing the power plants that were made in Iran. So not only the technical parts, but the power and the ability to complete something without anybody pressurizing you or any politics playing, I think this is a very, very good choice. Mm. And don't forget that what I must say is that building a power plant is not just building, it's not just equipment, you have to look at the delivery of the fuel, you have to look at the disposal of the fuel, you have to make sure that they will continue. You can't sort of discontinue because politically you've got yourself on the wrong side of some other country. So there are many advantages in this. Also maybe in the financing packages might have been also an advantage. Yes. Mm.
If I may say, of course, you know that this project was announced first in 1955. So we're not speaking about a new project, but we're speaking about a project that was stalled for many decades. Why was this project stalled up till now? And how far do you think we can really carry out with the project now?
Actually, as you mentioned, it is a political decision. From the 55, from the start of the installation of the international, the Egyptian Atomic Energy Authority, we were working together with India and Yugoslavia at that time.
Yes.
The in the 60s, Nasser made agreement with the Russian to build a nuclear power plant. It happened at the war of 67. That we consider that one of the goals of this war is to delay this project.
You mean here that in that was during the 70s?
Yes. No, in the 70s, in 1974, Richard Nixon made a visit to Egypt in 1974. And they made agreement with him in the time of Sadat, not Nasser at that time, in the time of Sadat. He made agreement with Richard Nixon for the states to provide us with two nuclear power plants.
Yes.
We got the bids from General Electric and from Westinghouse. And we made the evaluation. And in the time before signing, few days before signing, the states made some political conditions that they have to make inspections and they have to interfere and many things. So, and they know that Sadat will not accept it. It was refused. Then in the 80s, we started with the French. And we made mutual working groups together. I was involved with three of them at that time. And they were working as one team. Then Sadat was assassinated, and then Mubarak came. And they said, no, we can't make it with direct order to France, to the French. We should make it as international bid. And he knows that this international bid will delay the project at least 3 years.
It was delayed anyway because of what the they claimed that then the discovery of the gas, which was sufficient.
And it was delayed, and then it happened the Chernobyl accident. And he said, I am very keen of the health of my people and so on, so on, so on, and I will not make the nuclear project. And the minister behind me is making it to me headache about this, Mara Baza at the time.
Yes,
and I will not make it. At the time, I stayed at home 1 week because many people, I was sending them outside on our expenses in order to be trained. Then I joined the International Atomic Energy Agency. I worked for it for 18 years. Then Mubarak himself, again, in 2007, 2008, said we will revive again the nuclear power project. So I came back, but till now, we didn't
yet start. But this time it's serious. I am
optimistic. This time will work well.
Yes. Now, if we're speaking about some of the results of the studies prepared by several institutions, particularly from the IAEA, and the IAEA itself certified that the Daba was a very suitable location based on meteorological conditions, earthquake risks, groundwater movement, sea current and tides, and all these. How far do you think the IAEA would help out in facilitating this project?
Of course, this is an agency that works in this area, but like any other agency, like you need the United Nations Industrial Development Organization or this organization, these organizations are not really there to be responsible for implementing any projects.
No, but they can hinder.
They can hinder, yes. But don't forget that if you're clever, what is an agency? Is an agency is the membership of all the countries. So you have to lobby. You have to have the people standing with you. If you don't lobby, if you don't have people supporting, if you did not have people supporting us in going for an atomic solution, we would not have been able to do it. If it was another country, they would not have allowed it to do that. Before you allow anybody to get into the nuclear business, you must see, is that country on your side? Is that country responsible? Is that country, can we control it? Will they listen to our rules? That's why they were so upset about Iran, because Iran, when it got into it, it started developing on its own. It started not adhering to anybody. So that's why.
But we are completely different than Iran.
Yes, I know. Iran. So we don't have any problem with that at all. We are adhering very closely to the international community, even before the international agencies.
Right. Very much, hopefully,
yes.
So that we can be able to.
But I want to say something, if you don't mind, to initiate something.
Please.
I want to say something about atomic energy, with due respect, of course, to the experts sitting here. Look at the world. Who is the number one user of atomic energy in power stations? As far as I know, it is France. It means, as a percentage of the electricity being generated, France has got the biggest amount of generation in that.
Around 80%.
80%, it's very, very high. It's even higher than the other countries who are more developed. So it's nothing to do with development. It's the policy. They went for atomic energy for a very long time. Now, there's an element I want to throw into this, because it's a very important element. Yeah. It's not just the atomic energy. Do you know that atomic energy is clean? I mean, with pollution-wise, all right? Now, with the meeting coming up in Paris now, next week, everybody is going to have to adhere to the amount of pollution they are sending
climate
out.
Change,
China,
yes.
Climate change.
Yes.
China is in a mess because it uses coal. And United States is in a mess also because it's also using all kind of fossil fuels. Now, if you use atomic, you're not disqualified as a polluter of the environment. You might be more risk of accident or anything you say, but not as a pollutant. Atomic energy does not produce carbon gases which go up into the air and goes up to the ozone layer. So it is to the advantage of many countries to have part of their development in this area. But the one I would say, and I think my colleague would also say that, this is a very costly business. It's a very costly business per installation, not by running. Running, of course, is another story, but installation. And you have to also remember something, that having one station in Daba does not, and I repeat, does not solve Egypt's problem of generating electricity.
Exactly, and that
it's a very, very small thing. It's just to get into the international arena of atomic energy and to be part of the whole thing.
And that was my next question
yes.
to
oh,
me.
Just,
and
so we're cheating from each other.
So it takes me to the expected potentials and exactly what is expected from this project to provide Egypt, provide Egypt's electricity needs.
The first of all, the Russians are ready to build 4 nuclear power units.
Yes.
Each unit, 1,200 megawatt electric. Mm. So the 4 units will be around 5,000. Mm. 5,000, and we have our grid is now around 27 or 28. So you can imagine 5,000 relative to 28, how much? Mm. This one. The other point, which is very important for us, as he said in France, they have around 80% of their electricity by nuclear energy. Mm. Although in France they don't have any uranium resources, they import it. In Japan, they have around 50 nuclear power plants, nuclear power units, but they don't have uranium, they are importing it. We in Egypt, we have mines for uranium. We can get uranium from phosphate, and we have very good reserve from phosphate as just secondary product, which will not cost us anything. We can get uranium from the black sands, which is, we have plenty of them, and we are selling them as normal sand, unfortunately.
Mm. Raw material.
Yes, as raw material. So this nuclear project for Egypt, I personally consider it a matter of life or death. because we will not stop at 2 units or 4 units.
But how?
We will continue.
Yes. How would it cover the capacity of the Egyptian needs for electricity, and on how many years would that happen?
The construction of nuclear units takes from 4 to 5 years. Mm. It was before 10 years and 8 years and these things. But now it is from 4 to 5 years. Mm. As in Emirates, they are building it for 4 to 5 years. So it is not a big period. For the solar power plants, it takes 3 years. So only 1 year difference. The construction cost for a solar power plant is more expensive than the construction cost of the nuclear power plant of the same capacity. Mm. Can you imagine that? Mm. The kilowatt hour from the nuclear power plants.
Even in Egypt, while we have all this sun?
Even in Egypt, yes. Mm. Because it is a matter not from the sun. It is a matter of manufacturing the mirrors and these things. And this one point. The other point is that the solar power plants takes very extensive areas, which we can't afford it if we are going to add each year around 3,000 or 4,000 megawatt electric in order to cover the economic and the social development. We cannot cover them with solar. Mm. Mm. Solar is very important as complementary to nuclear energy and the complementary to coal energy. But if we apply coal, we should stick with the international measures in order to keep the environment clean. Mm. So it is complementing to it, but not substitute to it.
I think the answer to your question, I mean, it's a really, really good question. We can assume, I think everybody agree, we cannot fulfill the needs of this country by just atomic energy.
At the time being?
Because at the moment, politically, we are very, very strong. Our president is very, very active. He has managed to convince a major player in this area to build the power station. Who will know, as you know, politics change, that in the next 5 to 10 years, we will be able capable to get another.
No, sir, I guess that's so, another story, because we are not speaking anymore about the president or what he wants, but rather we are now trying to build what we can say institutions and long-term plans to be carried out by the institutions of the country.
But your question was atomic energy, will it solve the problem of Egypt by itself? I think the answer is no. You will still need fossil fuel a lot. Mm. You will still need solar energy. And if you want to just take one sentence about solar energy, we claim, and our colleagues in the electricity departments claim, that we will have 20% of our power needs out of solar energy. I do not think this is possible. We are now running at a much lower rate of that. And as my colleague said, it's very expensive. You need expensive land. The silicon cells are very, very expensive. Mm-hmm. So I think the answer to your question is atomic is not the only solution. In fact, France is now reducing it. Mm. It's going backwards. So I think we have to have a balance.
Yes. I guess he was speaking about the solar energy and not the nuclear one. I guess he said that the nuclear is much cheaper than the solar system, right?
Yes, the kilowatt hour from the solar energy is around 3 times or 4 times the kilowatt hour from nuclear.
So of how much it will cover our needs, that is very much questionable, because, and in which term, I mean, what is the period that it can really cover? I mean, in 5 years, it can cover like 10% of Egypt's needs from energy in 10
nuclear.
Years.
Nuclear.
The nuclear.
Mm. What is the percentage? I don't think it's going to be very high.
We'll speak about that and we'll continue our discussion. Let me first have this report. And head of the International Atomic Energy Agency, Yukai Amano, showed readiness to send a team to Cairo for assisting in outlining the frameworks for the proposed nuclear power plant in Daba area. And let's watch the story and we'll come back for discussion.
During his visit to New York last September, President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi met with Yukai Amano, Director General of the International Atomic Energy Agency, where both expressed interest in cooperating together in the field of nuclear power. Amano expressed his willingness to send a delegation from the agency to Cairo in order to assist Egypt in placing the regulatory framework needed for the establishment of the nuclear power plant set to be located in Al-Daba'a. He added that he is keen to provide Egypt with all sorts of technical support for using nuclear power in generating electricity in the upcoming period. Meanwhile, President el-Sisi affirmed that Egypt's interest in cooperating with the agency benefiting from its programs and expertise. He further highlighted the importance of nuclear power and its peaceful applications, which could lead to social and economic development. El-Sisi further stressed on Egypt's willingness to create the Daba'a nuclear power plant project to diversify the country's energy sources. He also indicated that the application of the plant is expected to be compliant with the international standards of the nuclear safety and security. The plant will be constructed in two phases. The Russian side company will construct four reactors of 1,200 megawatt capacity each, at a cost of more than $10 billion, while other four reactors will be offered for an international tender. The project is expected to boost the power production of the country to avoid power shortage and will help support development projects.
Right, back to our discussion and back to you. If I may ask, before we go to the security measures, so let me take it from Dr. Yusef Mazhar here. The Daba'a nuclear project, I mean, does it have the political dimension as well as the technical dimension? I mean, is it a strategic project rather than just a project being carried out?
Definitely, I would say, don't forget I'm more or less trying to represent the general thought around the place, not to be as technical as the people working in the field, who are naturally biased for their business. They know it, they are pushing it forward, and they are fighting to keep it alive and to expand it. Looking at it from different points of view, you see a completely different values and let's say pressures happening along this. It takes very long time to negotiate with a partner, to arrive at a partner, to build a power station. Even though we have the number of the first number, which was multiplied by four, because there are four, think how long it's going to take to be able to negotiate these four, find the locations for them, get, if you're going to be as friendly as you are now, with the main supplier, which is Russia at the moment, or will there be other players in the future who will come up onto the market, whether it's the French or I doubt whether the Americans will be on our market, but it could be another one. So thinking that the atomic power station, since I was a younger person until now, we have still been going forward and backwards along with it. So I doubt that we will be able to leapfrog into this so quickly with all this capacity that we're talking about.
Right. Let's wait and see. Dr. Oseiry, the IAEA will send its team in order to inspect the whole circumstances of this project. And this is what I was asking, how it will help us in this project. If I may ask you about the fields of cooperation between Egypt and the IAEA, and what exactly is it expected to do here? And also about the security measures we ourselves, the Egyptians, have prepared for.
Yeah. Even in the recommendation for Daba'a site, the Daba'a site was first selected by a French company, one of the best companies in the world in site selections. And the Daba'a site was selected among 23 sites in Egypt, and it was found that it is the best. We asked for the technical assistance of the experts in the International Atomic Energy Agency in order to come and to see the studies and also to recommend the site. They came, four of them, and they saw the studies. They made a visit to the Daba site, and they agreed that this site is one of the optimal sites in the world, not only in Egypt, because it is very close to the cooling water. There is very, very low earthquake magnitudes there. The site is not so much populated with people, and that is why it was very much optimum site. And also recommended by our local radiation and the nuclear center here in Egypt, which is belonging to the prime minister directly. We made also another group of people, 20 experts from all aspects of sites, and they came, they saw the study, and they agreed also upon it. Also, the company, Motor Columbus company, agreed on the site. So we have also Worldly Persons, the consultant Worldly Persons. So we have all people supporting the use of this site. And we have also other sites in our minds in order for more nuclear power plants to be built. But we don't want to declare them for
definitely,
the moment.
Definitely, at a time. What about the security measures that I've been asking about Egypt? Because as we all know, sir, at the beginning of the 90s, we've seen the Chernobyl crisis. And then very recent, we've seen the Fukushima crisis. And of course, people would really want to know how far Egypt has taken its precautionary measures not to or to avert being in a crisis. In
the Chernobyl accident, they exaggerated it very much in order to prevent the developing countries from going nuclear. Do you know how many people died due to the Chernobyl accident?
No.
Less than 50.
Okay.
This is the report of the World Health Organization. Less than 50. The land already was corrupted, but they scanned it, and now they are using it without any problem. For Fukushima, no one died because of the radiation in Fukushima. Only three people. One was making a maintenance on high chimney. The tsunami threw him away, and he did. And the two were in the turbine buildings underground, covered with water. So they were dead just because of the drone. But no one died because of the
direct radiation.
If I may take the nuclear aspect to Africa at large, and our, I mean here that many of the African countries are in the grip of nuclear fate. And from your point of view, would this be a kind of launch to such projects in Africa, putting into considerations many aspects like the ethical, the monetary, the safety, the security for all Africa?
Well, I would like to tell you something. I traveled Africa extensively. I think I was your guest on a number of programs about Africa. And I think Africa always seems to be looking in two directions, African leaders. They look up to North Africa and to Egypt in particular, because they believe, okay, United States is very developed and Germany is very developed, but they were always developed, okay. But Egypt, they recognize as have somebody who could do it, and they're closer to us, and if we can do it, they feel they can do it. They also look downwards. They look to South Africa. They look a lot to South Africa. Must not you must take care of it, because South Africa is very, very developed. So they also see, so If Egypt goes into nuclear, if South Africa goes into nuclear, I think that many of them will follow. But don't forget, people go into nuclear because they don't have the raw materials, and Africa is still very raw and still very virgin in all sorts, in timber, in coal, in all these things. So maybe the feasibility of going into nuclear will not be as strong in many, in some of them. But of course, don't forget, I'd like to call this a bit of a prestige project. If you, it's always good for a country to be able to say they're doing something in nuclear. And it's also a schooling, it's a culture. If you're in the culture, you come into things like you said about safety. Do you have the culture? You have the rules, we have no problem. The rules, the people have been taught, they have been examined, they've gone, they've come back. You need after that a culture of being very careful, a culture of being very accurate, a culture of not being careless. And this nuclear is not to be played around with.
What are the most suitable types of reactors that Egypt can really operate?
Actually, we decided upon pressurized water reactor. It is most widely used, first. Second, it is not monopolized by a single country. If we use heavy water reactor, it is only Canada. If we use boiling water reactor, only the States and Japan. But pressurized water reactor, we have Westinghouse, we have the French, we have the Japanese also, we have Korea, we have Russia, we have China, six countries. So if any country will try to make some kind of monopoly, something like that, as it happened in Iran, we will not be in awkward position. This one. The other point, which is very important also, the pressurized water reactor is safer than other types of reactor. And I can give you some, I don't know if I have it in, with me here or not.
Yes, but I guess we can look it over because I'm very...
83.
I have very... yes.
83% of the nuclear reactors over the world are built from this type of reactors. And the 63 of the way of the operating nuclear power plants of this type of reactor. So it is very important for us. It is much safer. For boiling water reactor, the steam comes through the fuel and it goes directly to the turbine. Which is not good if anything happens.
And is it much expensive or less expensive than the solar and the nuclear ones?
For the construction?
Yes.
No, it is cheaper than the solar. Of the same power, it is cheaper than the solar. I tell you something which will be very amazing to many people. For coal power plants, the ashes which is going to the environment has 100 times more radioactivity than nuclear power plant.
Yes.
Can you imagine that?
Yes, I can. I can very much indeed. Finally here, because and I'm very, I have very limited time here. What could be a possible risks for Egypt, or that Egypt can really face out of this project?
This project, you mean the last?
The Dabai, yes. The nuclear plant.
Look, I think, I've been through the, let's say, the temptation to make it. I've been through the enthusiasm. I've also been through the fear. I've seen the people who are against it, the people who have fought it. But I think that for all reasons, whether political, whether prestige, whether Egypt's position in the Arab world or its position in the whole of this area, you must get into nuclear to be part of the nuclear club, because you'll be missing a lot if you're not. We never know what will happen with nuclear after that, how it will expand. And if you don't get into it now, you will do, as my colleague said, you will go to sleep again. When they tell you you're not going to do anything, you're going to have all the people who are trained will go and do something else. So I think you must insist that you should take this step.
I guess so.
It might not be 100% the best step. It's not like building the four stations and starting electricity next year. But you have to do it.
Yes, that's it. I have to do it. Yes. Or Egypt has to do it. And at that, I have to end here because the time is out. Dr. Ibrahim Oseiry, Nuclear Affairs and Energy Advisor at the Ministry of Electricity, thank you very much for being with us. Dr. Yusef Mazhar, former Undersecretary of the Ministry of Industry, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
And dear viewers, many thanks for watching. Tomorrow would be another debate with another colleague. Good night.